Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Concussion Rescue, a comprehensive program to heal traumatic brain injury, by Dr. Kabran Chapek. Read by Rick Adamson. Publisher's note: the information presented in this book is the result of years of practice experience and research by the author. The information in this book, by necessity, is of a general nature and is not a substitute for an evaluation and/or treatment by a competent medical specialist. If you believe you or a family member might have a brain injury and/or are in need of medical intervention, please see a medical practitioner or go to the nearest emergency room immediately. This book is not a replacement for the medical assessment and treatment of a brain injury, including a concussion. Please see a medical practitioner or go to the nearest emergency room as soon as possible. The stories in this book are based on true events. The names and circumstances of the stories have been changed to protect the anonymity and privacy of patients. Foreword by Daniel Amen. Your brain is at the core of what makes you who you are. When it works right, you work right. When it is troubled, for whatever reason, you are much more likely to have trouble in your life. Many people think the brain is rubbery and fixed within the skull, but it isn't. Your brain is soft, about the consistency of soft butter, tofu, or custard, somewhere between egg whites and gelatin. It floats in cerebrospinal fluid and is housed in a very hard skull that has many sharp bony ridges. As such, it is easily damaged. Whiplash, jarring motions, think shaken baby syndrome, blast injuries, and blows to the head can cause the brain to slosh around, slamming into the hard interior ridges of the skull. There are several mechanisms of physical brain trauma: bruising, broken blood vessels and bleeding, increased pressure, lack of oxygen, damage to nerve cell connections, spilling out of tau proteins, which cause inflammatory reactions from brain cells that have been ripped open. In addition, because your pituitary gland, master hormone regulator, sits in a vulnerable part of your skull, it is often damaged in head injuries, causing significant hormonal imbalances. According to the CDC, there are over 2 million new head injuries in the U.S. every year. That means over the last 40 years, more than 80 million people have sustained head injuries. And the number of concussions is also rising, especially among children. From 2010 to 2015, concussion diagnoses jumped 43% among the general population. For young people 10 to 19 years of age, however, concussion diagnoses skyrocketed 71%. We have to do a much better job of preventing TBIs and repairing the brain when they occur. Common causes of head injuries include falls, falling out of bed, down steps, off ladders, slipping in the bath or shower; motor vehicle collisions involving cars, motorcycles, or bicycles, as well as pedestrians; violence, gunshot wounds, assaults, domestic violence, or child abuse; sports injuries. In addition to football, they are common in soccer, boxing, baseball, lacrosse, skateboarding, hockey, cycling, basketball, and other high-impact or extreme sports; explosive blasts and other combat injuries. At Amen Clinics, we see patients with head injuries from all of these causes. In particular, we have been studying the association between football and brain injuries for 3 decades. When I first started looking at SPECT scans in 1991, I saw Pop Warner and high school players between the ages of 8 and 18 with clear evidence of traumatic brain injuries. I was horrified. And then I saw college players whose brains showed even more damage. In the past decade, I've met with over 300 active and former NFL players whose scans were even worse. Yet, using the Amen Clinic's Bright Minds program described in this book, 80% of our players show improvements in blood flow, mood, memory, and sleep. At the time of this writing, more than 350,000 military veterans have sustained a TBI since the year 2000. This means the Iraq and Afghanistan wars will likely have a 70-year tail, as these veterans will have an increased risk for psychiatric issues and dementia. The impact of those TBIs will spread beyond the veterans themselves and affect their children and succeeding generations. Research shows that head injuries increase the risk of depression, anxiety and panic disorders, psychosis, PTSD, suicide, drug and alcohol abuse, ADHD, learning problems, borderline and antisocial personality disorders, dementia, aggression, homelessness, victimization, loss of or changes in sense of smell or taste. Head trauma may also increase the risk of incarceration. In the U.S., 25 to 87% of inmates say they have suffered a TBI compared with 25 to 38% in the general population. And the latest statistics from the Bureau of Justice Statistics show that 181,500 veterans are incarcerated. In our database of tens of thousands of patients, 40% had a significant brain injury before they came to see us. When people ask me what is the single most important lesson I've learned from looking at over 170,000 brain scans, I reply, "Mild traumatic brain injury is a major cause of psychiatric problems, and very few people know it." I actually hate the word mild applied to traumatic brain injuries or concussions, because it implies that they didn't cause lasting damage, which is often not the case. Anyone who has played a contact sport has likely also experienced many subconcussive blows where the brain was jostled but did not cause immediate symptoms. It is important to note that many people forget they've had a significant head injury in the past. At Amen Clinics, we routinely ask patients several times whether or not they have had a head injury. Our intake paperwork asks the question, "Have you ever had a head injury?" The historian who gathers patients' histories before they see the physician asks them again about head injuries. The computer testing we have patients complete asks a third time about head injuries. If I see no, no, no to the question of head injuries, I'll ask again. If I get a fourth no, I will then say, "Are you sure? Have you ever fallen out of a tree, fallen off a fence, or dove into a shallow pool? Did you play contact sports? Have you ever been in a car accident?" I'm constantly amazed at how many people think their head injuries were too insignificant to mention. For others, they simply do not remember the incident, as amnesia is a common occurrence in head traumas. When asked the question for the fifth time, one patient put his hand on his forehead and said, "Oh yeah, when I was 5 years old, I fell out of a second-story window." Likewise, I have had other patients forget they went through windshields, fell out of moving vehicles, or were knocked unconscious when they fell off their bicycles. Concussion Rescue is written by a smart, deeply caring naturopathic physician who has worked at Amen Clinics for many years. In this book, you will find hope, help, and a specific plan to improve your brain and rescue your mind. Daniel G. Amen, M.D., is the founder of Amen Clinics and the author of The End of Mental Illness: How Neuroscience is Transforming Psychiatry and Helping to Prevent or Reverse Anxiety, Depression, Bipolar Disorder, ADHD, Addictions, PTSD, Psychosis, and More. A note to the reader. I didn't plan or decide early in my career as a naturopathic physician to focus on individuals with brain injuries or brain disorders. When I first started working in mental health, however, I realized this was something I would be doing for the rest of my life because I loved helping people become their most effective selves. Working with patients who have brain problems is extremely fulfilling. because helping someone improve the health of their brain changes their life right now and for many years to come. I have always had a passion for helping my friends and family members feel their best by taking care of their bodies. This was part of my inspiration for studying natural medicine at Bastyr University, a world-renowned school for naturopathic medicine in Seattle, Washington. In fact, Bastyr is what brought me and my wife Dree to the Pacific Northwest. We hoped to build our lives in an area that fit with our values of natural health care and our mutual love of the outdoors. Working at a treatment center in nearby Edmonds, I helped people with severe depression, anxiety, eating disorders, and chemical dependency. Many of the depressed patients had recently been in a psychiatric inpatient unit for a suicide attempt, and this was their first step down to a less comprehensive level of care. For others, this was the first help they had found, sometimes after struggling for years on their own. The treatment center's mission was to have naturopathic physicians as the primary doctors, working with a team of other providers to take care of these patients. I developed a deep respect for the highly trained therapists, counselors, and dietitians on staff, and I worked closely with psychiatrists to provide whole-person care. Through watching patients struggle with depression, anxiety, guilt, and suicidal thoughts, I learned many difficult and wonderful lessons about how the brain works. I treated thousands of patients using nutritional interventions and saw amazing improvements with simple methods. In addition, I learned when medications are needed and can be life-saving. I saw patients' physical health improve, which in turn helped to lift their depression or help with behavioral or chemical addictions. Eventually, I became the medical director of this facility. I'm grateful for my time there and my training in psychiatry. My passion for psychiatry and natural medicine was ignited anew when I was asked to join the team at the Amen Clinics Northwest. Dr. Daniel Amen is changing the way psychiatry is practiced, and the model at the Amen Clinics fits exactly with my ideal of providing holistic psychiatric care to patients. I love both the cutting-edge research that we are doing and being able to help patients in our 8 clinics across the country. The integrative and progressive approaches we use are grounded in scientific evidence, which is important when it comes to something as challenging as brain problems. We are always looking for the best ways to help our patients, and I hope this book is one that parents, family members, caregivers, and healthcare providers can use to help those suffering with a traumatic brain injury. How to use Concussion Rescue. A concussion is a form of mild TBI, traumatic brain injury. Therefore, I am going to use the terms concussion and TBI interchangeably throughout the book. The same treatments and approach apply whether you are seeking help for a mild or more severe brain injury. Some of you are coming to this book because you have had a brain injury and haven't been able to heal, or a loved one has had that experience. Others may have had a brain health problem such as depression, anxiety, rage, attention difficulties, fatigue, or memory issues, and come to suspect that a past brain injury was the cause of your problems. Either way, this book will provide options for assessment and treatment. The information in this book is designed to be an adjunct to conventional medical care, not a replacement for it. Your healthcare provider can be one of your greatest assets in your journey to healing. For example, your provider may be able to order and help interpret the critical lab tests in the assessment phase of your program. Feel free to dive into this book at whatever chapter addresses your issue. For example, if you have just had a concussion, you may want to go straight to Chapter 5, First Aid for Your Brain, to find which specific nutrients can help right after such an injury. If you have chronic insomnia, you may want to start with Chapter 10 for some help getting a good night's rest. If you are considering hyperbaric oxygen, you might want to skip right to chapter 12. Whether you are a parent or a coach, have recently had a fall, or are a veteran struggling with the after effects of a past brain injury, I hope this manual guides you back to health. Chapter 1. Back to the Drawing Board. Kevin was an energetic high school soccer player who reveled in every game and practice, a fierce competitor who broke up offensive attacks with aggressive sliding tackles on the field. During a corner kick late in a scoreless game, Kevin positioned himself just outside the penalty box, knowing that his teammate would try to bend it like Beckham and give him a chance to headbutt the flying sphere into the back of the net. The corner kick came in high and fast, and a scrum of players from both teams converged on the ball. As Kevin leaped high for a header, his head collided with another player's skull. There was a sickening thud, and the youngster tumbled to the ground, where he cried out in pain. Play stopped after the goalie collected the ball, and half a dozen players from both teams gathered around Kevin. He wasn't knocked unconscious, but as he pulled himself to his feet, he was woozy. He was led off the field, where his concerned parents were waiting. When Kevin failed to shake the cobwebs out of his head, his father and mother rushed him to the emergency room. Following a long wait, a short examination, and a quick visit to the CT scanner, the ER doc informed Kevin and his parents that he would be just fine based on the results of the CT scan. Kevin had suffered a concussion, the doctor said, explaining that a concussion was a form of mild traumatic brain injury, or TBI. Kevin and his parents were told that he should feel back to his old self in a few days or a few weeks, depending on the severity of the concussion. He was directed to watch and wait and take Tylenol for a headache, which is standard protocol in the traditional medicine world. Instead of quickly recovering, as most teen boys do, Kevin experienced splitting headaches over the next few weeks that stretched into months. His headaches throbbed so much that he couldn't read more than a few lines of his textbooks at a time. When he fell further and further behind in his schoolwork, Kevin had to withdraw from school. Kevin ended up missing classes for several months because of his symptoms and became very depressed. Kevin's mom grew increasingly concerned and scheduled an appointment with me at the Amen Clinics in Bellevue, Washington. As a naturopathic doctor, ND, I had been seeing more and more post-concussion patients in recent years as parents sought treatment for their children who were not recovering from mild traumatic injuries. They hoped a more natural or alternative approach would be more effective. As a doctor of naturopathic medicine, my goal is to treat the cause and heal the injury versus just recommending over-the-counter pain relievers and rest. Conventional doctors willingly admit that their medical bag is nearly empty when it comes to effective treatment options for mild traumatic brain injuries. However, as you can see, there is nothing mild about Kevin's situation. My first interview with Kevin did not go well for the young man. When I asked him to describe certain events from the previous day, his responses seemed slow, and he had great difficulty remembering even simple things like what he ate for breakfast. After putting him through a battery of tests and baseline cognitive testing, I immediately started Kevin on a treatment plan consisting of targeted nutrients. I prescribed a formula, based on research, consisting of specific amino acids, vitamins, and minerals shown to be helpful at improving healing from brain injury. I also recommended significant changes to his diet. When Kevin's brain received the correct resources, he was able to move from a dysfunctional idling state into a more functional one within days. As Kevin's headaches diminished, he began to regain his memory. 2 weeks later, he was back in school and feeling much better about life. On his next visit, he asked me a hard question. Will I be able to play soccer again? I wouldn't want to roll the dice with your brain and your future, but the choice is ultimately up to you, I responded. To play soccer at the competitive level that he was used to playing, I said, would mean risking another concussion and therefore permanent brain injury. Kevin nodded to signal that he understood, but I could tell he was processing what this meant to his days of playing a sport he loved. Although it took him several weeks to get used to the idea, Kevin ultimately realized that he had gifts other than soccer. He decided to focus on academics and try playing non-contact sports in the future. Concussions like the one Kevin suffered are all too common. The number of brain injuries sustained each year is in the millions and continues to grow. According to the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, CDC, there were more than 2.5 million emergency room visits for a variety of brain injuries in 2010, the most recent year available for this vital research. A majority of those brain-related ER visits were from falls, unintentional blunt trauma, such as being hit by an object, vehicular accidents, and injuries suffered on the playing field. These days, it's estimated that 10% of athletes will experience a concussion during their season, according to the Sports Concussion Institute. Unfortunately, countless traumatic brain injuries go undiagnosed because many are brushed off as just a hit to the head, similar to what Kevin experienced. But thanks to increased media attention, like the movie Concussion, starring Will Smith as Dr. Bennett Omalu, the forensic pathologist credited with being the first to discover chronic traumatic encephalopathy, CTE, concussions are being taken more seriously. The word is getting out that repeated hits to the head and ensuing concussions cause long-term brain damage. The identification of the problem is only half the battle, however. Although advances have been made in emergency neurosurgery, which has helped save thousands of lives, it's well known among brain injury researchers that we don't have effective treatments for brain injury. In fact, nearly all of the over 30 large-scale trials in this field over the past 30 years have failed to find an effective drug treatment for acute brain injury. I believe the rising problem of traumatic brain injuries isn't being approached correctly, which is why it's time to go back to the drawing board. I'm not proposing that we start all over, but I feel we need to think differently about the way we approach brain injuries. We can start by looking at what happens with each individual brain injury and match each one with the right treatments. At Amen Clinics, we have a way of remembering to look at concussions in a comprehensive way using the mnemonic Bright Minds. Each letter stands for a different component that must be considered in order to have the best chance of healing from head injuries. In each chapter, I will highlight the Bright Minds principles that are key to focus on in order to recover from a brain injury. B. Blood flow. After a hit to the head, blood vessels can be damaged, leading to decreased blood flow. This must be addressed as a core piece of healing from brain injuries. Also, lack of exercise, less than twice a week, contributes to deficient blood flow and is a barrier to healing. R. Retirement, aging. According to the CDC, Centers for Disease Control, visits to the emergency room for TBI-related falls is highest among children ages 0 to 4 and adults 65 years old and older. The brain may be more vulnerable to the consequences of brain injury when the brain is first developing and when it is older, and there is less brain reserve and hormones are at lower levels. I. Inflammation. Brain injury involves an inflammatory cascade that occurs minutes to hours after a fall or an accident and smolders like a campfire that can last for months and even years. This inflammation is related to chronic symptoms of brain injury. Signs of inflammation can be measured as C-reactive protein and homocysteine in the blood. Lab tests will be discussed in Chapter 3. G. Genetics. People with the APOE4 gene have a higher risk of having chronic symptoms after a hit to the head, perhaps because individuals with the APOE4 allele may have a greater inflammatory response in general. H. Head trauma. A history of head injuries with or without a loss of consciousness can cause long-term problems and mental illness. Even playing contact sports without having concussions can cause damage to the brain, and the damage is cumulative. T. Toxins. Alcohol or drug abuse, exposure to toxins in the environment, mold, pollution, or from personal products, and cancer chemotherapy can all worsen brain function and make it harder to heal from brain injury. M. Mental health. Brain injuries are a significant cause of mental illness. Brain injuries are not considered most of the time as a cause of mental illness. However, studies have shown that TBI can cause attentional problems, depression, anxiety, and even psychosis. I. Immunity, infections. Damage to the brain can cause problems with the gut and digestion, creating an environment where food sensitivities can begin and lowering immune function, thus making the body susceptible to a chronic infection like Lyme or Epstein-Barr virus, EBV. N. Neurohormone deficiencies. Minor hits to the head can cause full or partial damage to the pituitary gland, causing hormonal deficiencies that may be the cause of some post-concussive syndrome symptoms, such as depression, fatigue, insomnia, low motivation, and attentional and memory problems. D. Diabesity. Having a diet higher in refined carbohydrates and sugars will put you at higher risk of not recovering from a hit to the head and makes it more likely you will have chronic symptoms after a brain injury. The brain needs the right kinds of fuel to recover and function optimally. S. Sleep. Brain injuries cause insomnia in a majority of patients who have a concussion, and this is one of the most important aspects to correct if healing is to occur. A large part of the problem in adequately treating brain injury is that the effects of brain injury are often not immediately evident. Here's an example. Dave, another patient of mine, enjoyed going out and drinking on the weekends. One night after leaving a craft brewery, he was jumped by a couple of guys waiting for him in the parking lot. It seems that the girlfriend of one of the guys had been two-timing him with Dave. This guy and his buddy assaulted Dave with baseball bats and smashed his skull in. He was rushed to a Seattle hospital that was world-renowned for brain injury and underwent emergency surgery. During the first month of recuperation, Dave appeared to be coming out of the woods, and before discharge, he scored well within the normal range on all of his cognitive testing. However, 3 months after the violent beatdown, he began to have severe cognitive difficulties. This delayed onset of symptoms, which is actually quite common, catches people off guard, since they do not suspect that their memory troubles stem from injuries sustained months or even years earlier. This explains why many are perplexed about why they are experiencing unexplained depression, fatigue, memory problems, dizziness, and headaches. This was exactly what happened to Dave. A good half a year after his injury, Dave couldn't hold on to his job, had difficulty speaking, and could not focus or concentrate for more than a few minutes at a time. He also acquired a rage problem, often exploding at the slightest perceived offense. We used to think that if symptoms or lack of function exist for more than a year after a brain injury, then it's highly unlikely there will be any further recovery. Fortunately, evidence is showing that with the proper protocol, significant improvements can be made. In Dave's case, we were able to raise his level of function and lower his anger enough to allow him to return to work on a part-time basis. Dave may continue to improve with further intervention, but there will be a point at which no further gains can be made. However, when it comes to your brain, we should try several different approaches, because your brain is just too important not to have it function optimally. Not every patient will improve as much as Dave, however. Some will improve more, some less, but the good news is that an improved outcome is possible. I have seen time and again that even years after their injuries, patients can recover significant pieces of brain function. Damage control. What happens to the brain after a traumatic brain injury, mild or otherwise? We don't know as much as we would like, but modern science agrees that a direct blow to the head causes neurons and blood vessels to stretch and tear, producing anywhere from mild to severe damage. What's interesting to me is what happens to the brain after the initial damage occurs. In most cases, a cascade of inflammatory chemicals called cytokines produces a release of excitatory neurotransmitters and an imbalance of amino acids. Other side effects are cerebral edema, swelling, a lack of nutrition to brain cells, inflammation, and decreased blood supply. These same mechanisms of damage occur whether the TBI incident is mild or severe. The extent of that damage is typically worse and more apparent in severe traumatic brain injury, where there is typically more swelling. That's not to discount damage from a mild TBI event, which can cause a host of problems. What I hadn't realized until I began working at the Amen Clinics is that every brain injury matters, large and small, and that brain injuries are a major source of psychiatric illness, even though the greater medical community has largely dismissed the link between TBI and mental illness. A brain injury is different for every person, because the mechanism of brain injury is complicated, and damage occurs not just at the site of injury. Therefore, treatments should have a similarly multifaceted mechanism of action. The beauty of natural treatments is that they contain hundreds of chemicals acting on many pathways simultaneously to calm the brain and begin the healing process. Many of the more successful treatments used in clinical trials have focused on reducing death rates by addressing primary damage. One of the treatments is craniectomy, which is removing a piece of the skull to decrease pressure. Another is hypothermia, which is lowering the patient's body temperature to cool down the brain and decrease swelling and inflammation, the equivalent of putting ice on a sprained ankle or bruised muscle. These treatments of primary injury have reduced the mortality rate and are nothing short of miraculous. In fact, the death rate from brain injury has decreased over the past 30 years from 40 to 50% down to 20 to 30%. At Stanford University, an undergraduate named Theodore Roth was part of a research project using an intracranial microscope to capture never-before-seen footage of what happens inside the brain minutes to hours after a traumatic blow to the head. The team implanted the microscope in mice's skulls. The mice were then struck on the head, and the internal results were recorded on the microscope. In his team's model of brain injury, Roth showed how highly unstable molecules wreak havoc and kill cells all around them. Oxidative damage, basically rust, also occurs. So, among other troubles, you can picture an injured brain as rusting out from the inside. This is what generally happens to the brain during traumatic injury. Tissues are torn, cells are damaged and turn rusty, and the brain lacks the energy it needs to heal. Inflammation of the tissues around the brain always occurs. So, how does the brain recover or cope? In naturopathic medical school, we learned that inflammation has three hallmark signs: redness, pain, and swelling. Imagine a sprained ankle. The lower leg is swollen with fluid, red, and sore to the touch. Through these reactions, the body is protecting the injured ankle. We may apply ice and elevate the leg to reduce these symptoms. The brain, however, does not necessarily appear hurt, which is why many believe they're going to be all right. The injury can't be seen. We don't see the swelling or feel the inflammation and heat associated with traumatic brain injury. And the brain is difficult to cool because the excess fluid doesn't have any place to go. When that happens, the excess fluid harms brain tissue simply due to the increased pressure it causes. The brain swelling can be gradual, which is why symptoms may not show up until weeks after injury. Earlier, I said that the key is to look at what happens with each individual brain injury and match each one with the correct treatments. What I love about the Stanford study is that the researchers did that. They saw oxidative damage and applied the antioxidant glutathione topically on the skin, which then passed right through the skull into the brain. Glutathione is the body's premier antioxidant and is produced naturally by the brain, liver, and lungs. This antioxidant quenches reactive oxygen directly and reduces cell death by 67% when applied immediately after a TBI event. When applied after 3 hours, glutathione reduced cell death 50%, which is still significant. With the help of the recent research, we have the opportunity and responsibility to act quickly and immediately after injury with treatments that can save brain cells. Now that we know that brain injury isn't a single problem, but a complex series of events and behaviors that varies among individuals, and that many of the single mechanism drug treatments can be harmful or even deadly, we should take a different approach. We should look to nature's potent non-toxic nutrients and therapies to come back from a traumatic brain injury, because natural treatments are some of the most powerful and effective treatments for traumatic brain injury. Why? Because the more similar the treatments are to natural processes, the less likely they are to cause further damage. By flooding the brain with nutrients that help correct dysfunctions of metabolism and circulation, we can start to repair the myriad kinds of damage caused by TBI. By taking a more natural approach to the treatment of traumatic brain injury, we have the hope of better outcomes for those suffering terribly and can begin to turn the tide of this silent epidemic. If you or a family member suffer a traumatic brain injury, you need to know the steps to take to rescue your brain. In the following chapters, I will outline a step-by-step program similar to what is used at the Amen clinics. Because brain injury is a complicated process, the solution must encompass more than popping a pill. By you giving your brain and body what it needs, healing can occur for a serious injury that was once thought to be permanent. I will cover what nutritional supplements to take for acute as well as chronic brain injuries. I will describe what foods can heal brain injury and which brain exercises, from low-tech options like meditation to high-tech ones like brain games, are helpful in the healing process. I've found that certain hormones are a cornerstone of treatment, along with solid sleep and vigorous exercise. I will also cover how to test for brain injury using imaging as well as lab testing. Let me assure you that healing from brain injury is possible, which is why I will share stories of those who have recovered. My hope is that Concussion Rescue will be an invaluable resource that will help you or your loved one to make it all the way back out of the fog and into the light of daily living, whole, complete, and your effective self. Chapter 2. The best treatment starts with an accurate assessment. Bright Minds Principles. When we assess for brain injury at the Amen clinics, we use our Bright Minds reminder. Blood flow. Brain SPECT imaging can measure if the brain has sufficient or deficient blood flow, a critical element to know, especially if someone is presenting with symptoms such as chronic fatigue, depression, anger, or headaches. Retirement, aging. As you age, the brain changes, and not for the better. It is sometimes difficult to know what is normal aging versus what could be the start of dementia versus what is impairment due to brain injury. Head trauma. After conventional testing, such as a head CT scan, has ruled out a brain bleed, it is important to investigate further. We recommend taking a thorough history to learn of past brain injuries and also run a series of assessments using functional imaging, computerized evaluations, and brain games done with good old-fashioned pencil and paper. Toxins. Functional imaging can show patterns consistent with the effects of toxins on the brain. Mental health. Mental health problems should be thoroughly assessed, ideally through the use of functional markers and not just based on symptoms. Immunity, infection. We use laboratory testing and SPECT imaging to detect infections and inflammation that may be changing how the brain functions. Only once we do a thorough evaluation and know what we are dealing with can we determine the best treatment plan and move toward healing. In a scene from the classic 80s film Ferris Bueller's Day Off, Ferris and his best friend, Cameron Fry, attempted to turn back the miles on the odometer of Mr. Fry's classic 1961 Ferrari 250 GT after a forbidden day of joyriding. The boys placed the Italian sports car on blocks, shifted the gearbox into reverse, put a brick on the accelerator, and hoped that the odometer would spin backward, erasing all signs of their adventure. The engine revved up and the tires spun, but the car wasn't going anywhere. And, if you will recall, things did not end so well for Ferris and Cameron when the car slipped off its blocks and plummeted backward down an embankment. Do you ever feel like you're on blocks and your wheels are spinning? Like you know something is not right, but you can't figure out what it is? Here's something you should consider if that's the case. Even the most effective treatment won't work if it's targeting the wrong problem. When that happens and your health is suffering and you just can't get an accurate or complete diagnosis, the process can be frustrating and demoralizing. Jane, a 35-year-old patient of mine, had been diagnosed with adult-onset ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, when she first came to see me. She had gone back to school to become a nurse and was struggling to keep up with her classwork. She felt overwhelmed, unorganized, forgetful, and depressed. She also complained of frequent headaches. Her previous healthcare provider had prescribed dexedrine, a stimulant, which helped a little but not a lot, even at higher doses. Jane's life had become so unmanageable that her aging parents had to step in and support her. In her patient history, Jane listed a number of concussions sustained as an adult in motor vehicle accidents, the most recent being a rollover accident. In the latter crash, Jane was able to walk away from the accident, although the emergency medical personnel that arrived on the scene insisted she go to the hospital for an evaluation. At the hospital, she was evaluated and released the same day. Her SPECT, single photon emission computed tomography, brain.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.